Welcome to the new session on Indian philosophy. In this session, we discuss on the topic Upanishads. Upanishads, Brahman. From the objective side, the ultimate reality is called Brahman. The word is derived from the root bra, which means to grow or to evolve. In the beginning, it meant sacrifice, then prayer, and then it acquired its present meaning of ultimate reality, which evolves itself as this world. Brahman is that which spontaneously burst forth as nature and soul. It is the ultimate cause of this universe. In the Chandogya, it is cryptically described as Tat Jalam, as that or Tat which the world arises, or Ja into which it returns, or La and by which it is supported and it lives. In the Taittiriya Upanishad, in chapter 3, the Brahman is defined as that from which these beings are born, that in which when born they live, and that into which they enter at their death, that is Brahman. The evolution of the elements is given in this order. From Brahman arises ether, from ether air, from air fire, from fire water, and from water earth. But the real theory of evolution is given in the doctrine of five sheets or koshas in the Taittiriya. The lowest level is that of matter, annam brahma or annamaya. Matter is unconscious and dead and cannot account for life. It is purely on the physical plane. Brahman cannot rest content with matter. The purpose of matter is fulfilled only when life is evolved. The highest state of matter is therefore life. Though matter cannot account for life, yet there can be no life without matter. The inorganic matter must be transformed into organic life. Hence, the second state of evolution is life. Prana is Brahma, pranamaya. Now, we are on the biological plane. The vegetable life emerges first, but the vegetable life must lead to the animal life. The vegetable products must be transformed into living animal cells. Life provides the universe and binds man with the rest of creation. But the destiny of life is fulfilled only when consciousness is evolved. Hence, the third state of evolution is mind or perceptual consciousness. Manas is Brahma or Manomaya. Here, we are on the mental or psychological plane. This state is shared by lower animals with man. Even this will not suffice, for there are intellectual facts which mere perceptual consciousness does not take into account. Hence, the fourth state of evolution is self-conscious reason. Vijnana or intelligence is Brahma or Vijnanamaya. Here, we are on the metaphysical plane. This state is the sole monopoly of human beings. Reason becomes self-conscious only at this state, and this fact distinguishes human beings from lower animals. The empirical trinity of knower, knowledge and known has been evolved, but even this will not suffice. There must be something higher than mere intellect, where existence is no longer formulated in terms of knowledge. The unity of existence requires that we must transcend the intellectual level. Reality is different from thought and can be reached in the Turiya state of highest immediacy, which transcends thought and its distinctions, where the individual coincides with the central reality. The fifth and the highest state of evolution, therefore, is the non-dual bliss. Ananda is Brahma or Anandamaya. Here we are on the mystic plane. The empirical trinity of knower, known and knowledge has been fused into a transcendental unity. Here philosophy terminates, the suggestion being that there is nothing higher than Ananda. From it all things flow, by it all things are sustained, and into it all things are dissolved. As all spokes are contained in the axle and the wheel, so all beings, all gods, all world, all organs are contained in the universal self, the Brahman. This Brahman is described in two ways in the Upanishads, cosmic and acosmic. It is called cosmic all comprehensive, full of all good qualities, saprabhanja, saguna and savishesha. And it is also called a cosmic, qualityless, indeterminate, indescribable, nishprabhanja, nirguna, nirvishesha and anirvachaniya. This distinction is the root of the celebrated distinction made by Shankaracharya between God and the Absolute. The former is called lower Brahman or Apara Brahman or Ishvara and the latter higher Brahman or Parabrahma or the Absolute. The cosmic Brahman is regarded as the cause of production, maintenance and destruction of this universe. All beings arise from him, live in him and are absorbed in him. The Mandukya calls him the Lord of all, the knower of all, the inner controller of all. Like sparks arising from fire, like earthenware arising out of earth, like gold ornaments being made out of gold, like cobweb coming out of a spider, like the musical sound coming out of a flute, the entire creation arises out of Brahman. Just as when clay is known, everything made out of clay becomes known, for it is the only name and form. Similarly, when Brahman, the cause, is known, everything being a mere effect becomes known, for the effects are only names and forms. The reality is Brahman alone. The acosmic Brahman is the transcendental absolute, the Turiya or the fourth, the Amatra or the measureless, the Anirvajaniya or the indescribable. The absolute can be best described only in a negative way, though it is not itself negated by it. Yajnavalkya describes it thus. This is the imperishable, O Gargi, which wise people adore, and not gross, not subtle, not short, not long, without shadow, without darkness, without air, without space, without attachment, without taste, without smell, without sight, without ears, without speech, without mind, without light, without breath, without mouth, and without either inside or outside. It does not eat anything, nor can anything eat it. The negative description of Brahman does not mean that it is a blank nothingness. It only signifies that the absolute cannot adequately be represented by the categories known to human thought. It is not this, not this, nedi nedi. The best possible description gives is Satchidananda, Sat Chit Ananda. Sat means existence, which points to the eternal nature of the absolute compared to things of temporal existence. Chit means consciousness, which shows that it is spiritual. The last epithet Ananda stands for the blissful nature of the reality. The terms are interpreted also as Satyam or truth, Jnanam or knowledge and Anandam or infinite respectively. The Brihadaranyaka describes Brahman as the real of the real or Satya Satyam, Brahman and Atman. The two, the objective and the subjective, the Brahman and the Atman, the cosmic and the psychical principles are looked upon as identical. Brahman is Atman. The different conceptions of Brahman correspond to the different ideas of the Atman and vice versa. The highest Brahman, which is Ananda, is just Atman as realized in the fourth or the Turiya state. There, the object and the subject are one. The seer, the seeing eye and the object seen merge together in one whole. The microcosm and the macrocosm are blended together. In microcosm, we find the three states of walking, dreaming and sound sleep. And we find the self as the fourth, the immanent yet transcendent reality. In macrocosm, when we identify the Atman with the self-conscious individual, Brahman is viewed as a self-conscious Ishvara with a force opposed to him. When the Atman is identified with the mental and the vital self of man, Brahman is reduced to the Hiranyagarbha or the cosmic soul, which comes between the Ishvara and the soul of man. This Hiranyagarbha is looked upon as related to the universe in the same way as the individual soul is related to its body. When we identify the Atman with our body, Brahman becomes the cosmos or the Virat. Virat is the all, the hypostasization of the conception of the world as a whole. It is the totality of things, the sum of all existence. The absolute is pure existence, pure knowledge and pure bliss all in one. It is called Satchidananda. It is Satyam, Jnanam and Anandam. By knowing it, the unseen becomes the seen, the unknown becomes the known, the unthought of becomes the thought of. All this is beautifully described in the Chandogya in a dialogue between Uddalaka and Shvetaketu. The father teaches his son Shvetaketu thus. In the beginning, Sat alone was without a second. It thought, may I be many. Then it evolved itself into this manifold world. Though, O Shvetaketu, art that Tattvamasi Shvetaketa. This teaching blends the subject with the object, the indubitable with the infinite, the microcosm with the macrocosm. The practical teachings. The practical teaching of the Upanishads is devised to bring about Brahman realization. It aims at the rectification of our thoughts and of our deeds. Broadly speaking, the course of discipline prescribed comprises two states: cultivation of detachment or vairagya and acquisition of knowledge or jnana. 1. Cultivation of detachment or vairagya. The prime object of Upanishadic discipline is the removal of ahankara, which is the basis of all evil, and vairagya is the name given to the attitude towards the world which results from the successful eradication of the narrow selfish impulses for which it stands. Its accomplishment necessarily presupposes a large course of training through the three ashramas or disciplinary stages, those of the religious student or brahmacharya, the householder or garhastya, and the anchorite or vanaprastha, so far as they were understood at the time. As the very word ashrama or toil means, they are stages of strife when selfishness is slowly but steadily rooted out. This training leads to sannyasa, but we should remember that the term does not yet bear in the Upanishads its present significance of a formal stage in the spiritual ascent of man. It there means only the transcending of the triple mode of ashrama life and is regarded as a consequence of Brahma knowledge rather than a means of attaining it. In the later sense, sannyasa appears comparatively late. The Upanishads, while fully recognizing the value of this preparatory training, do not ordinarily dwell at length upon it. They rather take it for granted and address themselves to such as have already successfully undergone that training and have acquired vairagya. 2. Acquisition of knowledge or jnana. Evil being due to a misconception of the nature of reality, its removal can be only through right knowledge, and if the cultivation of detachment is also laid down as necessary, it is only to render the acquisition of such knowledge possible. Detachment is a precondition of right knowledge. The training of the second stage is threefold: Sravana, Manana and Nididhyasana. Sravana stands for the study of the Upanishads under a proper guru. He that has a teacher knows. It defines the place of precept and tradition in the training. It also means that the influence of an ideal is never so great on us as when we are brought into personal contact with one who is a living embodiment of that ideal. Though necessary, Sravana is not enough, so it is supplemented by Manana or continued reflection upon what has there been learnt with a view to get an intellectual conviction regarding it. This training is to be further supplemented by Nididhyasana or meditation, which assists directly in the realization within oneself of the unity underlying the multiplicity of the universe. Nididhyasa is the highest form of meditation and is possible only after considerable practice in concentration of thought. Hence, the Upanishads prescribe several meditative exercises of a preliminary character. They are called upasanas. In upasana, the thought may be directed wholly outwards and to selected objects. Both external may be mentally identified, as in the meditation of the universe, as a horse allude to above, or only one external object may be chosen and it may be thought of as identical with the contemplative's own self. There is one important difference between the two forms of meditation. While the former affords exercise only in concentration, the latter gives scope in addition to the cultivation of sympathetic imagination, the power to place oneself in the position of another. It accordingly serves as a more direct aid to Brahman realization, wherein also what is contemplated through Brahman is to be identified with the contemplative self. Again, the objects of contemplation may be real object or only symbols. Among real objects, which the disciple is asked to think of as one with Brahman, we often find conceptions which were once taken for ultimate reality itself, but which in course of time, as philosophic thought progressed, were superseded by higher conceptions. Such, for instance, is the cases with prana, which marked an actual stage in the evolution of the conception of the absolute. Among the symbols used for Brahman may be mentioned the famous Om, the mystic syllable, which finds a very important place in the Upanishads. Whatever form these meditations may take, they prepare the disciple for the final mode of contemplation as Aham Brahmasmi, or I am Brahman. When a person that has morally purified himself and has, after formal study and reflection, convinced himself intellectually of the truth of unity, succeeds through Nididhyasana in transforming what was heretofore known only meditatively into an immediate certainty, he attained the spiritual goal. It is, however, only a very few that can achieve this goal. The Upanishads themselves refer to a knower of Brahman as a rarity. Moksha or release. Moksha or release is the goal of every man, and release consists in the soul's freedom from the need to be reborn. There are two views in the Upanishads regarding the nature of the goal. One view is that moksha is attainable only after death, that is videha mukti. The other view is that it can be attained while one is alive. It is known as jivan mukti. According to this view, since moksha is a state in which ignorance is dispelled by knowledge of the true self, and for this one need not wait until the death of the body. Is the highest state of religious realization, the atonement with the Supreme Godhead, a mere vanishing into nothingness? The Upanishad view is that there is, in the highest condition, a disintegration of individuality, a giving up of selfish isolation, but it is not a mere nothing or death. As the flowing rivers disappear in the sea, losing their name and form, thus a wise man, freed from name and form, gives to the divine person who is beyond all. The liberated condition must be looked upon as the fullest expression of the self. The highest is a state of rapture and ecstasy, a condition of ananda, where the creator as creator is abolished but becomes one with the creator, or more accurately realizes his oneness with him. We cannot describe this perfection adequately, we use symbols. The nature of eternal life is a condition of ananda or freedom, a state of joyous expansion of the soul, where heaven and earth are felt to flow together. There are passages where the individual is said to become one with the highest. The pranava is the bow, the atman is the arrow, and the Brahman is said to be its mark. It should be hit by one who is self-collected, and that which hits becomes like the arrow, one with the mark, that is Brahman. Here, absolute identity between the soul and Brahman is asserted. Aham Brahmasmi. The knower of Brahman becomes Brahman. Brahma vid Brahmeva Bhavati. There is no sense of individuality, and there is no possibility of action in the higher state, when Yajnavalkya explains it to Maitris in the words. As a lump of salt which is thrown into the water dissolves and cannot be gathered up again, but wherever water is drawn, it is salty. So truly is it with this great being, the endless, the unlimited, the fullness of knowledge. From these beings it came into view, and with them it vanishes. There is no consciousness after death. According to the Chandogya, immortality is lifting oneself up to the region of deity. Mundaka holds it to be the companionship with God. Absolute likeness with God is also suggested. Almost all Indian thinkers are agreed that moksha is release from birth and death. Union with God is another name for becoming eternal. When eternity is translated into the terms of the phenomenal world, it becomes birthlessness and deathlessness. Now let us summarize. Brahman and Atman are the terms used in the Upanishads to stand for the ultimate reality. From the objective side, this ultimate reality is called Brahman. In the Taittiriya Upanishads, in chapter 3, the Brahman is defined as that from which these beings are born, that in which when born they live, and that into which they enter at their death, that is Brahman. The theory of evolution is given in the doctrine of five sheets or koshas: Annamaya, Pranamaya, Manomaya, Vijnanamaya and Anandamaya. Brahman is described in two ways in the Upanishads, cosmic and acosmic. Atman is Brahman. The practical teachings of the Upanishads is devised to bring about Brahman realization. Moksha or liberation is the ultimate destiny of every jiva. Now, I give you a few assignments regarding this session for you to work out. 1. Explain the Upanishadic conception of the relation between Brahman and the world. 2. Discuss Jivan Mukti. 3. Explain the theory of evolution. 4. Discuss the two stages in the realization of Brahman. 5. Write a note on a cosmic Brahman. You can refer following books for further study. 1. C. D. Sharma, A Critical Survey of Indian Philosophy, Motilal Banarsidas, New Delhi, 2003. 2. Dr. S. Radhakrishnan, Indian Philosophy, Volume 1, George Allen and Unwin Limited, New York, 1971. 3. Robert Ernest Hume, The 13 Principal Upanishads, Union Theological Seminary, New York, 1930. 4. Structural Depths of Indian Philosophy, P. T. Raju, South Asian Publishers, New Delhi, 1985. 5. Outlines of Indian Philosophy, M. Hiriyanna, Motilal Banarsidas Publishers, 1993. Thank you for watching this program. Hope you have followed this session clearly. Let's meet in another session with another topic. Bye.